And the analysis of Shields and Brooks, syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. Gentlemen, great to have you back with us this Friday. So they have capped the well in the Gulf, but the oil is still coming out. The president, Mark, was back down there today, second trip in a week. Do you see a change in the White House approach?
Certainly. I mean, I think today's repeat visit by the president was indication that he'd received loud and clear the criticism he had gotten from both Democrats and Republicans, that he was not as visible, his presence was not as visible as it had to be. And it, now we're seeing the narrative of the whole story, Judy, move from the well and the gushing a mile below the surface to the havoc, whether it's people's lives threatened and livelihoods threatened, beaches, birds, fish, as we saw it. Raise peace. I mean, it's just the oil is now just a reality, and regardless of when we stop it, even though it hasn't been stopped, that's the story.
So, David, does this make it look like the president is more in control of what's going on?
Well, the oil is still gushing. There's still the bad ambiance. The oil's still coming out. Nobody knows what to do with it. And I think people rationally know there's nothing the president can personally do about something, but still the ambiance is bad, and they want to see some reaction. I personally don't hold him responsible for any of this. Somebody had a good line that we elected a guy who was cool in a crisis, and now we're upset because he's cool in a crisis. And so I personally don't hold him responsible. People want to have a sense that he's more emotionally engaged. I thought today was a good step. Just in theatrical terms, not the best step. I still want to see him surrounded by fishermen, mm-hmm. by regular folks down there, and he still hasn't done that. Within the White House, though, they've done something quite intelligent, which is to create a separate team that's just going to do this. Because one of the things that's a challenge for people in these circumstances is to pay serious attention to this, but not get consumed by it. Jimmy Carter was consumed by the Iran hostage crisis, the Clinton people with some of the scandals. They couldn't get anything else done. And I think they've done the right thing, which is to get some serious people involved, but still have most people going about the regular job of the presidency, which is the right way to handle it internally.
And Mark, you said last week that you thought the president needed to show more feeling. I don't remember the word that you used, but you said he needs to demonstrate that there's a feeling. And I was going to say today, yeah. or yesterday, I guess, he told in an interview, he said on CNN, that he doesn't think he should do that.
Well, I think part of the job description of a president is not simply commander-in-chief, it's comforter-in-chief. And that really is. I mean, Ronald Reagan did, after the Challenger crisis, really bound up the nation at a terrible time. President Clinton going out and welcoming back the caskets from the embassy assassinations and murders. I mean, those are important acts for a president. And I really think that's part of the job description. He doesn't have to emote. He doesn't have to pretend to be what he isn't. But I think there is a sense of communicating that at the highest levels of power and authority in this country, there is an understanding of the human factor in this. I mean, David mentioned the fishermen in particular.
In addition to blasting BP, which is what he was doing again today, saying they're spending a lot of money on advertising, but they need to spend money on the people.
Yeah, I think that's moderately effective. I'm not sure. But people want to know that the communication with the government is two-way. And that doesn't mean you just sit with a series of government officials in your shirt sleeves at around a table. It means you're in a non-governmental setting where most people are, at a restaurant, maybe out on a boat with people. And I think that so far, theatrically, they haven't done that. But then, again, I should stress, that's theatrics. And it's important, but it's not the most important thing. I think on the substance of the matter, they're doing reasonably well. They're being people are angry for a lot. There's still the cry, do something, but what are they supposed to do? I think they're doing substantively what they can.
The other big story today, Mark, was the jobs numbers came out, unemployment numbers for the month of May. There was an increase, but not as much as a lot of the experts had hoped. Implications for the administration here?
Well, I mean, the good news you can get by very quickly. Unemployment fell from 9.9 to 9.7, sixth month in a row of creating jobs, positive numbers. But underneath it, not good, Judy. I mean, the jobs were overwhelmingly in the Census Bureau. We only do that once every 10 years. We can't do that. We can't keep them on much longer. In fact, many of them will expire in June. Only 41,000 jobs created in the private sector. The market obviously responded, as markets do, rationally or irrationally. It expressed its judgment on it. And the most difficult thing in the world, I saw Democrats trying to do this today, including the White House, you know, put out the good news. When you're one of 15 million people who are unemployed, and some of whom have given up after being out of work for more than 6 months, even looking, the last thing in the world you want to hear is things are getting better. When it's 15 million. That is an impossible message to deliver politically, to communicate to people.
You mean because there's some people still
don't.
The
sense of anger. I mean, don't tell me things are getting better. I've been out of work for 6.5 months, 9 months, and that's a difficult message.
Yeah, maybe we could take a census of China or keep those people on. then you get to the question of what are we going to do about this, because the long-term unemployment, the number of long-term unemployed, is truly horrific, even by any historical standards going back to the Great Depression. And so the question is, do we have another set of job creation, other stimulus bills? And the thing that's worrying, I think, about these numbers is that, as a number of economists said, the economy is sort of churning along, but people don't want to hire because they're not sure if this is a sugar high. This is a temporary set of growth, so they don't want to hire long-term. So it could be people think, okay, I see some energy, but that's because the government is running a 10% deficit, and that's going to go away, and then all the growth will go away, so I don't want to be stuck with a lot of long-term employees. So in a weird way, I think some of the stimulus spending, while doing some good short-term, is also raising a lot of anxiety long-term and sort of dampening down some of the hiring.
I mean, you're hearing people say, well, they've spent all this money, and yet they're only creating 40-some thousand jobs.
Right, because I think we've talked about this before, it's the psychology. You know, you can pump numbers into a macroeconomic model, but people are basically anxious for future taxes because of Greece, because of a million of other things. They're still not going to hire, and the psychological switch has not occurred.
A different jobs question, Mark. The offer by the White House of a job, one of three jobs, to a Democrat running for the Senate in Colorado to keep him from challenging the Democrat who was already in the race. This is on top of the Pennsylvania.
It's the third time. I mean, the late Bill Sapphire said had a rule of three. You had to have three separate instances or incidents before a story really got legs. This is the third one. Remember David Patterson, the governor of New York. They ham-handedly, on the day the president, was visiting New York, they tried to get him out of the race. He was later withdrew because of an ethical question of his own. But then Joe Sestak against Arlen Specter in Pennsylvania, and then Andy Romanoff against
Michael
Bennett.
And they all turned it down.
Well, that's the big thing. I mean, there are two factors come out of this. First is it violates the marvelous rule that I learned from Speaker Thomas P. O'Neill, which is never write what you can speak. Never speak what you can whisper. Never whisper what you can nod, and never nod what you can wink. And the idea of the White House putting out a menu...
I think I follow that.
Okay, we're putting out a menu of three jobs, in print, email, and sending them out to Romanoff and say, do you want column A, column B? Well, there was no offer made. But the more important and significant development is that in both instances, Inspector and Sestak, in Sestak's case in Pennsylvania, and Romanoff in Colorado, is that they felt that defying the White House by going public on this would cost them nothing and actually help them politically. And I think that's an unsettling message for the White House to receive.
Right. I mean, if you want a job, if you're unemployed, run against a Democratic incumbent. The offers will start coming in. And I do think that's it. This is an anti-establishment year. And we've seen it already in a number of cases, but it's also even true within the Democratic Party against a Democratic president. It's sort of a badge of honor. We don't know if Romanoff will win in Colorado. I sort of doubt it. But nonetheless, it's clearly a case where you want to stick your thumb in the eye of the establishment, and that's going to make it hard for party leaders to run campaigns, because nobody's going to listen. And you get bonus points for not listening. And so that makes it hard to establish party discipline.
So that means the White House has no clout?
Well, they have
situation.
Some clout, but obviously less. I mean, people are casting a lot of blame on the White House political operatives. I sort of don't blame them. The atmospherics are different. Look, we've got a lot of races where we've seen what's happening this year, and we're probably going to see a lot more of it in Nevada, maybe next Tuesday at the primary there, that the furthest ideologically extreme candidates are doing well, and the anti-establishment candidates are doing well, and it's just tough if you're in the establishment.
This is unfair to ask you about this in just a couple of minutes, but Israel, Gaza, the attack on the flotilla of ships, there's another flotilla coming. The Israelis are threatening to stop them. How does the Obama administration deal with this?
Well, they're doing it in a muddy way. Of course, I want them to be honest about it, which I think the true thing is that Israel was morally justified but politically stupid to do this. Gaza is run by Hamas, which is threatening its destruction. Israel allows 10,000 tons a week of stuff to go through that into Gaza. They could have channeled the humanitarian aid that way. They wanted a confrontation, but Israel was phenomenally stupid to walk into this trap just politically. And the Obama administration is trying to walk down the middle and just being fuzzy about it between Turkey and Israel and really making no one happy. But I really don't see another way for the Obama administration.
It's a headache.
It's more than a headache. I mean, it is, one can argue about the illegality, the immorality of what Israel did, but no one can argue against the stupidity. It was isolating. It led to worldwide condemnation. It put the United States in a terrible position. It put Turkey in a terrible position, the one Muslim country that had been open and dealing with the Israelis. Put the United States, as General David Petraeus said earlier this year, and testified that this weakens the United States and its ability to be an honest player in the Middle East in the resolution with other nations, simply because we are seen as being too pro-Israeli and uncritically supportive of Israel. And I think what complicates it all is that Prime Minister Netanyahu feels threatened at home politically by his own political right. And the way to reestablish, as we all know, a political leader who's beleaguered is to introduce a foreign threat and to stand up to international pressure. He's easy to do that because President Obama is not popular in Israel, because he, ironically, is seen as too pro-Palestinian and not sufficiently uncritically supportive of Israel.
It was unfair to ask you, but I did, and I thank you for your answers. Okay. Mark Shields, David Brooks, thank you both.
Thank you.